I'm here with Councillor Robert Nemeth for the Wish Ward for this episode of The Vote. It's been a bit of a long time. I haven't really caught up with you so much over the lockdown, Robert. Last time we spoke, I know we were via Zoom. So city's starting to get back to normal a little bit more, isn't it? People are getting out a bit more. But we've got a long way to go in the city, haven't we? Now, we're going to focus on the Wish Ward and the seafront and what's been going on down there.
Yeah, sure. So seafront in my own ward and lots of Hove has been slightly depressing over the whole COVID period, with things like crime going up. I'm pretty sad to see events happening every week, really, on the beach huts, which I love, which is a real downer. And you've probably seen in even the national press some of the big battles that have taken place on Hove seafront. So that's been the sad side of COVID. Yeah. But I mean, there's lots of positive things to take out of it as well. I mean, residents have really been bandying together to try and get to the bottom of some of the crimes which have been taking place. And
that's it, low-level crime then, is it? Or
it's all low-level stuff, but if you're the victim of it, it doesn't feel low-level. I mean, for example, if in my ward and the adjoining ward, about 30 cars were keyed in the same Saturday night 3 weeks ago. Well, it's called low-level crime, but if it costs you £300 or £400 to fix your car, it doesn't feel low-level, does it?
No. What's been done about that then?
I've been going out on patrols with the police, working very closely with our local PCSOs. I mean, two reasons for that, really. Try and show, a united front with the police to try and calm residents, but also to just work with the police, try and share intelligence, just really to show which streets are worst affected, that kind of thing. So, yeah it's two reasons, two pronged, really.
Yeah, because the crime went down, didn't it, in the city during the lockdown, obviously, because most people went out on the street. But now it's picking up a bit, so it's something to look out for, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a different type of crime, though. I mean, it's groups forming in the night and then going out and doing silly things. It's a different type of crime.
Yeah.
I can see why burglaries would go down. I mean, the streets were clearer and more people were at home. So you can see why standard burglaries would go down. But this sort of low-level stuff, it feels like it's gone up, but I haven't analyse the figures yet.
Yeah. And what about on the seafront? I know you had a lot of people concerned about large gatherings on the seafront. Obviously, it's now legal to go on the seafront and to enjoy the space there. But we've had, as you say, groups of people there. But do you feel it's too crowded on our seafront, or have we got it right now?
No, I definitely haven't got it right now. But, the seafront's meant to be welcoming. So you can't sort of say to... I don't want to live in the sort of city where you're saying no all the time. But if you're going to have these big groups, they can't leave all that litter. They can't put tents up and stay for 2 or 3 days. You know, they can't run on the beach hut roofs. So I think it's just with rights comes responsibility, which is a fairly basic thing that we should all agree on, really. But we can't have these big scenes, these big fights, these big drains on police resources where 10 cars have to turn up and deal with, silly battles of drunk kids. It's ridiculous. Yeah.
What about the community action in the Wish Ward? How have the community been putting together there? Is it still carrying on as it was during the...
Yeah, I mean, all my favourite groups, Hove Beach Hut Association, Friends of Hove Lagoon, Friends of Stone and Park, all of these different groups, I mean, Friends of Wish Park, all of the different groups have been, Kingsway and West Hove Residents Association, pulling out all the stops to try and share. Well, the themes early on in COVID were looking after... That was the initial... drive, wasn't it, to look after vulnerable residents. And I think the community and probably the council and individuals as neighbours stepped up, and that worked out well. I mean, so that's praise for anybody who helped anybody else out of the goodness of their heart. So that side of things went well. The community stuff for groups was really interesting. I'm sure it'd be studied in the future, because it suddenly meant 99.9% of people who'd never used Zoom or Skype before suddenly had to work out how to do it. So every community group, which would normally meet, in the pub, in the community room, at people's houses, suddenly couldn't. So I think there was a bit of a lag where different groups suddenly had to get their heads around the technology.
Yeah.
But they did, and it's worked.
Yeah, exactly. Do you see that community spirit staying then? I've just... interviewed JJ Waller, a photographer, recently. He went around Brighton and photographing people, during a lockdown. He's hoping that spirit continues. Do you see that continuing? I mean, we're kind of community-minded in Brighton anyway.
Yeah, I didn't notice a drop in community-mindedness, but maybe it would just be different.
Yeah.
Maybe just a bit more technology friendly. I think it's a human psychology question, really, isn't it? Because I think people have embraced the technology because they want to see people where they haven't been allowed to. But I also think people are probably now craving human contact. And
yes.
That's why you're having this sudden, you know, bursting out of breaking the rules, because people, we're...
Yeah, just some people going a bit further than others.
Yeah, we want to see people in real life. I mean, the same applies to work. I mean, I haven't fully got my head around it, but the reports are the office sector is doomed. And lots of people have probably enjoyed not having to go to work because they can change their routines in the morning, see the kids. But if your whole job all day just becomes looking at a computer screen, that is fairly depressing, I think.
Yeah.
So I think there'll be a lag where it goes back the other way.
Yeah. How's it for being a councillor then? Because I've had lots of, I've done loads of Zoom interviews myself. I know the council's still doing meetings via Zoom, apart from some special meetings, as I understand it, where, you know, it only takes two or three people.
Yeah.
Does that work quite well? Because it's...
Yeah, I mean, I've got no complaints. I mean, I'm a 24/7 councillor anyway, so I work hard, whatever the constraints. So I'm not hugely different. I mean, I still wish I could do more. Still wish there was more hours in the day, but...
Yeah. What's going on? I'm seeing King's House there then, and that's being up and running. What's going on with some of these developments? There's some big things going on. Blackrock being one, we've got the gasworks there that got planning permission recently. Brighton's going to change, isn't it? Lewis Road by the Brighton University, it's all going up, all the accommodations.
Yeah.
It looks quite...
Even in Hove, I've got three big schemes ticking along in my part of town, where on Portland Road, a large scheme just got planning permission. I mean, there were over 200 objections and the council pushed it through.
I saw that. Six houses being knocked down, I think.
That's it. Bottom of Olive Road, very busy traffic spot. So that's got outline planning permission now for high number of flats in a very busy spot. The Port Z development, now called the Gateway Scheme, which is on the seafront overlooking Shore and Port. Two-storey houses opposite, 11 storeys proposed. That's going to be going down very badly amongst my own residents, and there's an appeal soon to be heard about the block of flats between Berrydale and Braymore Roads in Hove. And again, I'll be supporting the residents. We managed to get it turned down first time, and this is sort of round two for us.
Is this the future might look like this, because we're going to have lots of empty shops. People are saying, well, put them into flats. We're going to have, people are going to say, well, I can knock down six houses. I can make a profit, but also provide double the amount of houses, whatever. More housing units, they're hard to turn down those applications, aren't they? Because we need more housing in the city. But obviously, from the residents' point of view, people don't want to be staring at a block of flats when they were staring at a semi-detached house.
I mean, again, tricky question. I mean, if my personal view is I don't get up in the morning, as an environmentalist, I don't get up in the morning wishing the population numbers were rocketing like they are. But if you embrace mass population increase, you have to build more homes. You can't have it both ways. If you want the population to go up, which I personally don't, you've either got to build in the city in a very dense way or build on this fabulous national park, which for me is an absolute no.
Yeah.
But I wish we weren't having to do either, because
it's
very environmentally unfriendly.
But it's going to be hard to turn down, isn't it, I think, in the future, if we are going to kind of welcome more people to the city. We're going to need more housing for it. And
it's legally impossible to now turn down, because the government says if you want your population to go up, then you've got to house people, which is obvious, really.
Yeah.
The government can't not say that.
Yeah.
You can't have an increased population and say no more homes.
Yeah. What can people do then if they've got a housing application? Because I can see there being quite a few applications going through now. There probably would have been a lull during the lockdown, but now we're back, you know, kind of a lot of people are back now, aren't they?
So how to have your say?
Yeah.
Well, you've got to get your councillors involved. That's what they're there to do. So if you feel under attack by somebody in the, property developer, you need to work with your councillors and then have a conducive and decent working relationship with developers so that you try and get a win-win-win. So on the Portland Road scheme, although lots of residents were very, very upset by it, and my fellow councillor, Gary Peltzer Dunn, and I spoke against it, our campaign did lead to the scheme halving in size. So it felt like a loss, but in some ways, it was worth the battle.
Yeah.
Because we made a hell of a lot of progress.
A lot of people get sad, don't they, when they see like family homes being knocked down and then flats being built in its place, because it's not how you kind of your vision for the road is often doesn't see you thinking, oh, well, there's going to be two blocks of flats there. You kind of like it to be almost...
Well, because it doesn't create a sense of community,
usually.
I mean, most people living in a standard house where they're an owner-occupier has a good relationship with their neighbours, and they come out in the morning and they're very happy to see people that become their friends. But as soon as there's a large block of flats next to houses, I think it's quite rare that people in the flats where their front doors are tucked away somewhere else in the building become friendly with those in the houses next door. I mean, there's lots of blocks of flats in my part of town, and I just don't see it working that way.
Yeah. In the second half, we're going to be looking a lot more at the developments, the gasworks, particularly in Black Rock. Just a quick discussion about Madeira Drive. We can carry it on the second half. It's being pedestrianised at the moment. I know the Conservatives have had a plan to make it one way. Just briefly explain that.
OK, so this is the brainchild of traders on Madeira Drive themselves, and Councillor Lee Wares, who's the Conservative spokesman on transport. And hopefully we'll go into this in a bit of detail, but there's a fantastic compromise position that keeps businesses, especially those in the tourist trade, disabled drivers, standard motorists, tourists happy. And we found a good compromise.